I can see that.
When I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the roaring thunder, that far throughout the when Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation to take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the Self family, I want to take this opportunity to welcome you to our service this morning. And on behalf of Pat Manor, we want to extend our greatest sympathy and condolences to the family of Nancy. And we assure you that we are here to support you. Before we begin this morning, let me invite us to bow our heads. Close our eyes. Father, you created man in your image, and you give man dominion over this world. And we are thankful that you have given us the assurance that you will never leave us nor forsake us. So as we begin this service in remembrance of our dear beloved Nancy Silk, we pray that your presence will come and rest with us. Comfort us as we weep and as we mourn. We pray, O God, that you will continue to let your presence be felt. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen. I want to say that I started at Pat Manor in March of this year, and within my first week, I was able to meet Nancy. And to be honest, it's one of the person who will always give me instructions. She will always tell me what to do, and a lot of the times when I pass, she always will say, I need you to come to my room and talk to Clarence. And I'll be telling him, no, I need you now. And I said, Nancy, just give me a few minutes, let me get around, meet some other people. No, I want to talk to him now. And so I will go and I will talk to Nancy. But this morning I want to talk to us a bit about sadness, about death. The Bible reminds us and gives us the assurance that at the loss of a loved one, we will experience pain and sadness. But I want to assure us this morning, in spite of losing someone we love, it is not the end. And many of us, if not all of us, are afraid of dying. I, for one, don't want to die. And it's something from a little child I've been praying for God to let me to live until he comes, because I don't want to die. And I remember at the age of 9 years old, my grandmother died. And the night they were having the service, and I saw my mom putting food and cake and all of that in her room. And being an inquisitive little boy, I asked why, and they said, oh, your grandmother is gonna come later on tonight and eat that cake and bread. And so I waited, and every now and again I would peep in the room and the food is still there. And I became hungry. And so I went in and I ate the food. I won't tell you what happened next. We are afraid to die, and we are afraid to see what will happen after. But my mom always says, in the midst of life, there is death. Life is short and uncertain. In fact, James says, what is your life? We are just a mist. appears for a little while and then we vanishes. Moses said in the book of Psalms 90 verse 5 to 6, "You sweep men away in their sleep of death. They are like the new grass of the morning, though in the morning it springs up new, by the evening it is dry and withered." It is sometimes said that nothing in life is sorted except debt and taxes. But when I look at how the world is going today, I can say this is not so true. Because a very good, wealthy man can hire a good lawyer, and he can work around that tax and get, if not all of his taxes, escape or pay little for tax. So the same is not true. Because once you have money and you can hire a lawyer, you can get away with paying much tax. But there's one thing for sure we can't get away with. We cannot run from death. Death is certain to all of us. So regardless of how rich we are, whether we are Christian or not, whether we are a believer or not, regardless of how much we may have accomplished in life, the type of vehicles we drive, or the house that we live in, how decorated our wardrobe are, how beautiful or how handsome we may look, there's one thing certain: we do not know what tomorrow holds. We can plan as much as we want. In fact, the Bible says, when man planned, God wiped out. Because God is the one who holds tomorrow. Statistics have shown that worldwide there's approximately 56,600,000 people die each year. That means that 4.7 million people die per month. 155,000 die per day, and 650 per hour. And when it comes to minutes, 107 people die per minute. Socrates says, "Of all the greatest wonders, none is greater than man. Only for that can he find no cure." Wouldn't it be amazing if we could have found a cure for that? Man find cure for cancer, they find cure for everything. But the only thing we cannot find cure for is that. And the reason is, the Bible says, when God spoke with Adam in the garden, God said to Adam, "The day you eat of this tree, you shall surely die." Meaning, Adam disobeyed God when his wife brought him the apple and he ate. And because, the Bible says, because of Adam's disobedience, sin passed upon all men, and so was death. So, Romans 5:12, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and by sin death, and so death passed upon all men for all that have sinned." There are two views about death in Christianity. One is that when you die, you go immediately to your reward. That is either heaven or hell. The other view is that when a person dies, they sleep. And sometimes I wonder when I hear people say, "Oh, your mother or your father is in Portobello and they want to come out and you have to pay." The Bible doesn't teach that. Jesus says when he went to visit Lazarus, Lazarus is sleeping. So the Bible teaches that death is asleep. And when a person dies, they sleep until Jesus returns. So this morning I want to assure you that when Christ returns, we are going to see that again. However, the Word of God only teaches one, that the second coming of Jesus will only be good for those who believe in Him. John says, don't be surprised, indeed, the time is coming when all the dead in the grave will hear His voice and will come forth. They will rise again. Those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life, and those who have done evil will experience judgment. It is pretty clear, but wait. David says, Daniel says, many of those whose bodies lie dead and buried will rise up, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting disgrace. David assures that a person when they die, they remember nothing. So there are people who will come and tell you, oh, your grandmother said you can do this. That's not true. Because in fact, the Bible says, the wise man Solomon says, when a person then even their thoughts is perished, they can't remember where they live. They don't remember anything. In fact, David says, we must praise God while we are alive, because when we are in the grave, we cannot praise God. 1 Corinthians, Paul says, for this corruptible body, when Christ come, will change into incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying, O that, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? That, where is thy sting? You see, Jesus has given us the assurance that once we trust in Him, He will give us the power over death. Because at His resurrection, He insulted death by saying, I have the key to life and to death. I am the resurrection and the life. And those who believe in me, though they are dying, they will live again. Someday, we will give up our thing, this old body of ours, this sinful body, and we will replace it with a body that is incorruptible, that is made by God's hand. Death is not the end. Death is not reincarnation, as some people teach us. That when you die, you will come back either by like an animal or something. The Bible does not teach that. Death is not evaporation. Death is not annihilation. Death is a trading. Meaning, we are trading this sinful body for a different body. One day we will trade in our old broken down bodies for a new body. Paul says, it does not matter in what form we die, where we die, or when we die. But he assures that if we believe in God, one day God will raise us from the dead. Many have gone before us, and many will follow. He says in Hebrews, we have a great cloud of witness. Those who have gone and before are looking on God, says, referring to those who would have gone to heaven, like Moses and Elijah and Enoch. While others say they have time, but I declare to us this morning, we do not have time. Time is not ours to determine when we die or when we live for God. That is why it is important that each day we live, we take it one day at a time, doing the best we can. Not just for ourselves, but to help others and to do what is right. I have gone to funeral. In fact, just a couple months when I was in Edmonton doing a funeral, I have seen children all mercilessly crying, lying down on the ground when their parents died, because they did not take the opportunity to ask for forgiveness for something they have done to their parents. And now their mother or their father died, and they don't have the chance to say, I'm sorry. Do not be like that. Each day you are alive, give God thanks and reconcile with people you have done wrong to, or who you think may have done wrong to you. Because when that strike, there is no more chance to say I'm sorry. Nancy may not have been the best mother. She may not have been the best sister, or the best aunt, or may not have been the best wife. But I'm pretty sure she would have done her best to raise her family in the best way she can. And I can assure you this morning that there are four things that never comes back. This feeling aura, words that are spoken, time that is wasted, and neglect opportunities. Every day we live, and I want to talk to the children now, make sure you make it right with your parents. Do not wait until they are dead to say I'm sorry or to say I love you. Husbands, do not wait until your wife is dead to say I'm sorry or I love you, or to your children. Time does not come back. In fact, the Bible says, now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why? Do you not even know that what will happen tomorrow? What is your life? You are a myth that appear for a little while and then vanish. This is according to James chapter 4 and verse 13 and 14. When I met Nancy, there was one thing that stands out to me with Nancy, and that is she is a very outspoken person. Whatever she has to say, she will say it with force, whether you like it or not. And I remember after promising her I'm going to come and talk to Clarence the first week, when she saw me the next time, she said, Pastor, you did not come, and I don't like it. And I said to her, Nancy, I'm going to be there. And when I went, Clarence was asleep. And she said, go in his room and wake him. And I said, can I do that? She said, yes, you can. He's pretending he's sleeping. I said, no, he's sleeping. I said, I just came from his room and he's sleeping. And she said, are you going to wait? I said, no, I can't wait. I'll come back when he's awake. So Nancy would have done her part. And I can tell you and give you the assurance this morning, just before Nancy died, that evening I went, but before that, when she was celebrating her anniversary, I can see the stress on her face. And I spoke with her. I said, Nancy, this will soon pass. Just enjoy the moment for now. Don't do too much. And at the end, you will be happy. And so the day before she passed, I went to spend some time with her. And I said to her, are you okay now? Even though she could not speak. And she rolled her eyes and she looked at me. I said, what you were hoping for has finally ended. And I believe you are settled now, you have renewed your vow. And with rolled eyes, she stretched her hands to me, and I held her hand. And I said, are you happy now? And I can see her eyes moving. And she squeezed my hand. And I know for sure that she was happy. Because all she wanted was to know her husband loved her very much. And so I said to her, I said, I'm going to pray with you. And she squeezed my hand and we prayed. And during the time we were praying, I noticed something, that her breathing changed. She was no longer trying to gasp for breath, but she was breathing smoothly. And at the end of the prayer, when I was speaking to her, she started gasping for breath again. And after I leave that room, I said to the head nurse, Nancy is not going to live until the weekend. So in fact, I don't believe she might live until tomorrow. However, if she does, we'll have to put her on EOL. Not realizing that she have already make up her mind and decided, okay, this is what I wanted. And I believe in my heart that God knows that that is what she wanted. Just to set herself to know that her husband loved her very well. Because you can ask anybody apart, man. Nancy, regardless of where Clarence is, if Nancy doesn't see him, she's going to shout to the top of her voice. Clarence, where are you? What are you doing over there? Come here. That's who Nancy is. And when I saw her in that moment after the prayer, I realized that she was settled and she was happy. And so when I got in the morning, I was told she passed. And I prayed and I said, God, thank you. Because I believe she is happy. And you have heard our prayer. This morning I want to say to us, don't wait until it's too late. We do not know when we are going to die. And in fact, the Bible says you can die before your time. Solomon says that in Ecclesiastes. Why die before your time? The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of reckoning. Today is the day when you make it right to God. I am not challenging Nancy now. I'm challenging every single one of us who are here. If we have not made it right, we need to do so before it is too late. At the end of each day, the Bible says we have to give thanks because God is the one who gave us the strength to own whatever we earn. David said, if he takes our breath away, we die. And sometimes when I see people boasting and getting on, I just bow my head. And I say, God, have mercy. I've heard people say, oh, it's my life. I live it all I want. No, it's not your life. We are living in borrowed time. So while we're living in borrowed time, let us make the best of it by doing the good that we can do. As we remember Nancy today, I want to challenge us. I want to ask us this question. How will you stand on that great day? Will you be found before God wanted, or will you be found with your sins washed away? When Jesus says to the north, let go, and to the south, hold back not my people. Paul says, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which gave us the victory through Christ Jesus over death. This morning, the victory is yours. but only yours if you claim it. What will you do with the victory that God has given this morning? Will you accept it or will you reject it? That is not the end. The Bible says, after death, there is judgment. And all of us have to face that one day. And when we go to the grave, we came from dust, and the Bible says to dust we will return. When we go to the grave, that's it. Probation is closed for us. We cannot repent. We cannot ask for forgiveness. We have nothing, Solomon said, to do with anything that takes place under the sun. All we are doing is sleep until God returns. This morning, what will you do with the opportunity that he gives you while you are alive? Forget about the past. Forget about what you have done in the past. Make the decision today. And as from today, go forward. You're going to use the opportunity that God has given you to do the best you can to the people around you. We can't buy our way out of hell. But we sure can live the life to avoid hell. Invite us to bow our heads this morning. Father, to whom shall we go when you have the word of eternal life? As we bury Nancy today, there may have been things in our life we haven't said to her that we should have. Many a times people wait until someone dead before they can give them something. They bring flowers. We bring all sorts of gifts when a person dies. But what can the person do? But we are alive. And you have given us one more opportunity to make it right. So as we remember Nancy today, I pray, oh God, for her family, her children, her grandchildren, her relatives, everybody that has to do with her, that this morning, oh God, you will touch them wherever they are. Give them the assurance that it is well with her soul. Give them the assurance this morning that you will never leave them nor forsake them. In fact, you said in your words that you will keep us in perfect peace if our minds are stayed on you. Yes, we may be sad inside. We are grieving. But tears are a language that only you understand. So forgive us for the times that we messed up. Forgive us for the things we should have said to Nancy that we didn't. Forgive us for the times when we should have been there for her, but we didn't. And so this morning, I lift her children in a very special way. That you will comfort them in times of their sorrows. That you will give them strength. That, oh God, you will give them direction, knowing that you are with them. Let them not lose hope. Help them to recognize that when your son Jesus comes, they will get a chance to see Nancy again. So as they mourn, oh God, nothing wrong with crying. Because even Jesus cried when he saw the destruction of Jerusalem. So nothing wrong with crying. In fact, it is said that when you cry, it helps to release the stress. So help us that in our mourning, in our crying, that we will remember that there is hope. That we will know that Jesus stands beside us and he feels the pain that we are going through. I can remember, oh God, when I lost my mom, I said to you, I am not serving you again. But I realized the Bible says we cannot kick against the prick. And so I humbled myself. And I pray this morning that you will be with Nancy's children, the grandchildren, the family, everybody, comfort them. And as we go through the rest of the day, help us to remember that there is nothing we cannot do with you by our side. So take away our stress, our pain, and may we rejoice because Nancy no longer has to suffer, no longer has to feel the pain. She is now waiting for your return. So help us to wait for your return. As we live, we will keep our minds stayed on you. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. So you don't have the eulogy now, but okay.
Mom was born May 11th, 1935 at the St. Thomas Hospital. She was brought home by her dad, Emil, and mom, Grace Picot, to the waiting arms of her three older sisters, Lucy, Joan, and Marlene, located in East St. Thomas on 320 Holden Street, an area referred to as the dump. Mom attended King George V School, where she found her love for drawing. Leaving school, she found employment at Kahane's Hand Painting, bringing an extra income to the family, which customary back then. At the age of 17, she met the love of her life, Clarence. They were wed on August 2nd, 1952. After a short stay at her sister's Joan and her husband Morris, the Sutter's place on Cavanaugh Street, they moved to 1060 Newton Street. Along came her two kids, Tim, born 1953, and Rory, born 1956. Next stop was buying a house at 108 McNeese West Transpose. After a few years, Dad took a transfer to Brandon. Off we went and lived there for 3 years. I remember hating Brandon. I think Tim would agree. That just went to show how strong and probably terrified at the time that my mom having to leave her family and friends to go live somewhere she'd never been before. She was our rock. After the 3 years, back to McMeans we came. It was a fun time growing up. Mom was a stay-at-home mom for the most part. If we needed to find her, she would be at one of the neighbors having coffee. Mom liked to have fun dressing up for Halloween and bowling in the St. Thomas Mix League, to name a few. She also loved traveling, driving to the East and West Coast, to LA a few times, flying to Hawaii, and she even went on an ocean liner. She could also spin a few white lies. She told me a story of when my hair got really curly. A couple of girls from the street asked, "How did my hair get so curly?" She told them she would curl it every morning before school. Not sure if the girls believed her, but of course it was not true. "Mom knew how to press my buttons. We would play pool in the basement. I would always clear the table and her having most of her balls left. Of course, I would scratch on the eight ball, her winning. She would snicker. I can only laugh about it now. She worked at the Transcona Florist, tending to customers and making deliveries. And the occasional beer, I might add. She also worked at Walmart as a greeter. Mom liked to plan things so our family would be together, especially breakfast at the Belgian Club on Mother's Day, where she would pay for everything. Or trips to the States, Gimli, Heckle Island, and Willard Lake, to name a few. After Tim and I left the nest, me three or four times, and started having families of our own, this became one second chapter of life. At this stage of her life, she was focused on the role as a grandma. She built special relationships with each grandchild, which she developed nicknames for that she continued to use until her final days. The grandchildren fondly remember nicknames, 20 years of block parties, building forts under the pool table, many sleepovers, trips to McDonald's, and many special songs she's taught them, which they remember to this day. Unfortunately, the great-grandchildren did not have more time with her. After many memories were made at McQueen's, they chose to downsize, moving to Appleton Estates on Niagara Road, where they made new friends and participated in many activities. I call it a painting place. Too much drama for me. Mom still was able to have special dinners for as many who could attend, crammed in the apartment. I think I missed a page here. Bear with me. After Mom was hospitalized, Dad and Mom both found themselves at Park Manor, where Mom and Dad lived side by side. On July 29th, we celebrated the 71st wedding anniversary, renewing their vows with family and friends in attendance. Near the end, all she wanted was to see her grandkids and great-grandkids. She was like a second mother to some, and all the kids of friends and cousins, she was referred to as Auntie Nancy. One last thing, she would always refer to me as her baby boy. 66 years old. She would tell the nurses, the cleaning people, other residents. She would take great solace and knew that at times it bothered me. She would say to me how I had to endure it as a child growing up. She was a baby of the family. Suck it up, buttercup. I will now miss that. We will always love you, Mom. rest in peace. And we will take care of that. Thank you.
It is always an emotional moment when you remember the things that your parents does. I want to just open the floor for a little moment to give any of the family members or any friends who want to make a contribution, say something about Nancy that they can remember, just for a few moments before we pray. Okay, that's good. I want to also assure the family that we at Patmana are there for you, and I want to assure you personally, whatever I can do to help, just reach out to me and I will do my best to make sure you guys get to this moment peacefully. At this moment, we're going to listen to a song, and while the song is being played, I want us to reflect a bit on the life of Nancy and the moments she spent with us. And then after that, we are going to pray. To stand. And I'm going to ask the family members as far as possible if we can hold each other's hand as we pray this morning and give support to each other. Father in heaven, it is with great sadness that we come to you this morning with broken hearts. But you have given us the assurance that before we call, you will hear. And while we are yet speaking, you will answer. I cannot say how the family is feeling, But I know how I felt when I lost my mom. So I experience what it is to lose a loved one. It's not easy. Especially the moment, oh God, when the coffin is going down in the grave, and you know that's the last time you're going to see that person. But I pray this morning, oh God, that in spite of our brokenness, that you will reach out to us. That you will not leave us nor forsake us. That in spite of the pain in our hearts, that we will feel your presence moving in us. Be with the family, oh God. I want to pray especially this morning for Clarence. I know, God, he has not fully come to terms with it yet. Maybe he did not realize what's going on as yet. But I pray, oh God, that he will continue to be the joyful person that he is. That you will comfort him. I pray for Tim, I pray for him this morning. I pray for their children. I pray for their families, their grandchildren. Lord, it is not easy when a relationship is broken. But you have assured us in your words that, oh God, you will comfort us just like you did with Mary when they lost Lazarus. And so this morning we are asking for the tears we are crying, for the pain we are feeling, for the sadness in our heart, that you will come and sup with us this morning. That you will open our eyes and give us the assurance that someday we will see Nancy again. So, Father, come, touch us, abide with us, and lead us as we go forth from today forward. May you make a difference in our life. Help us not to be afraid to reach out for help, even if it is a prayer or a word of encouragement. Because sometimes, oh God, we think that we can carry the burden alone. But burdens are lifted at Calvary. Thank you for the assurance this morning. That in times of our pain, that in times of our sorrows, that you will not leave us nor forsake us. So bless us this morning and give us hope as we pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Oh.
Hello. I know I tried to ask to get everybody in the class. celebration.
Yeah. And it did, it wasn't in the paper until the Saturday.